Divine Truth Assistance Group. Group assistance sessions putting principles of divine truth into action. This recording is from the Developing My Loving Self group and is part of an Education in Love series. In the Governing Emotions presentation, Jesus defines governing emotions, discusses three groups of governing emotions, shows how governing emotions have a major impact on our lives, and stresses the need to develop a will-based desire to develop faith and release terror. Recorded on the 7th of June 2016 in Noosaville, Queensland, Australia.
Turn myself on. Just wind myself up. Yep, I'm on. Okay. Good morning. Good to see you. How are you? So what we're going to do now is this discussion about governing emotions. Now, before I proceed on this particular discussion, I would like to say to you that, firstly, the next 2 days, most of you are going to struggle a bit in terms of understanding it with your soul. Now, normally what happens when you start struggling understanding it at soul level is you start getting real resistive, right? All this judgment about, oh, I'm not understanding, why am I understanding, and all this stuff kicks in, right? And that's a bit of a problem, because what that does is it stops you from just being open and allowing the information just to soak over you without that sort of resistance to learning being there. So what I'd suggest that you do is attempt to just realise that, well, where I'm at is probably at the accepting facade stage, right? So you know, by the morning of the second day, we're struggling a little bit because that's where we're at. And that indicates where we're at, what we're struggling with indicates where we're at. So we're at this stage of understanding my facade and getting to the stage where I, you know, get to accept it without judgment and with compassion. Right? So that being that the case, you can see that by the time we start discussing some of the things down here about what to do about this, we're going to struggle with the process a bit. And so what we're doing here now is presenting to you things that are ahead of you. The problem with that, to a degree, is that firstly, it can, depending on your choice, create a bit of fear in you, which then makes you worry about the whole thing, right? And that causes a resistance in itself. But secondly, it can also make you feel like, I've got to get it. And we're not suggesting you have to get it. What we're suggesting is that these things will be ahead of you. Once you actually start getting into these phases emotionally, you'll get it. Every single person who's ever done this, and this is the beauty with God's way, every single person who ever does it God's way gets through the same stages no matter what. Now that's reassuring, isn't it? That's the beautiful thing about God's way. So even if you don't get it today or tomorrow or a week's time or a month's time or 2 years' time or 5 years' time, the key is to work through the issues emotionally to the point where you can. And that requires, of course, the use of your will. The second thing I'd like to mention is that governing emotions and the other three talks that we're going to be giving in this section are all about removing my unloving self. So the theme of the session is about removing my unloving self. Now, if we're yet to accept my unloving self, can you see that we can't really get started on removing my unloving self? Can see that? So you can see that you can't sort of jump ahead. Many of you have tried jumping ahead plenty of times, right? And you've become very frustrated with that. And in fact, for many of you, that's even caused you to think that maybe the whole thing's a crock of crap, really, you know, and maybe I should just ignore the whole lot, right? Because you've been trying to jump ahead and process through things without seeing that there are emotions upon emotions. And this brings us to this discussion that we want to have with you today, this morning, governing emotions. What are governing emotions? Good question, isn't it? Well, governing emotions are like keys to doors. And a lot of people talk about their emotional state as if it's sort of like layers of an onion type of thing. You know, how you, and I've often sometimes drawn that in the past, how you've got a layer and then you've got a layer and another layer and another layer, and you've got to strip off this layer before you get to this layer and so forth. But the reality is, for myself, probably a better way of drawing it is like, it's like a house with a passageway with a whole heap of rooms, right? And each room has a locked door, right? So we've got a locked door in each room. Now we can walk down that passageway and walk through the entire house and never open any of those locked doors. And that's what we've been doing with our life. And that's what the facade's all about. Never opening the locked doors. Never opening the doors that are going to be the source of any pain or terror or confusion or any other emotion that would be unpleasant. So what we do is we finish up with our life, we finish up bolting the door on that unpleasant experience. And then bolting the door on that unpleasant experience. For many of us, more unpleasant experiences that we have, the more doors we bolt. And then in some cases, we have a series of unpleasant experiences altogether. And that's like a little mansion of its own of unpleasant experiences. You know, so we what we do with that is we put that out in the backyard and then we build over the top of it. You know, like we put a whole heap of plants or something, pretty it up so it looks nice, and so we can ignore that altogether. That's what we do with that when there's a whole heap of pleasant, unpleasant experiences. So your emotions are, so if you could think of each of these rooms as having emotions in them, the unpleasant experience having a series of emotions, in other words, some pain that got created, right? And then if you can think of the door as the governing emotion, the secret, the key, the key you're going to have to use to unlock that door to get into those particular emotions. Does that make sense to you? Another way of thinking of it is almost like, and I've also found it this way with myself, it's like having a ball of thread with one little tiny thing coming out like that. It's like a little, the end of the thread. And you could think of it as governing emotions are like grabbing the end of that thread and pulling. And if you don't touch the end of that thread, then the ball won't unravel. But if you just pull on the end of the thread, it just keeps going, keeps going, keeps going until it's ending. Does that make sense? But there's a beginning emotion that's like grabbing the end of the thread. Does that make sense? Yeah. So with these governing emotions, if you think of them like doors to rooms, doors to groups of emotion, and you could almost say that your terror is like, in some ways, the main doorway in to everything. You could almost say that, couldn't you? But the reality is what you're going to find is that you'll get through one group of emotions and you'll think, oh, I'm done with that. And that room might have been cleared out, but then you might come against another room that you didn't even know existed. It's almost like this, where each room has, each room has some other rooms in it. And you don't know that until you walk through the first door, do you? And then all of a sudden you realize, there's some more doors here. And you'll have to find the key to those doors as well at some point. Does that make sense to you? Yeah? And we've created a sort of labyrinth of emotion that we bundle together and then put behind lock and key, and then we bury that deeper and deeper and deeper. So it's not going to be a well-planned house. It's going to be a house that was done ad hoc. You know what I mean? As demand. So sort of, you know, if you see this some shanties, like if you go into a shanty town, or Mary lived in a refugee camp or something, this is how it often is, where one thing gets built, without planning for the fact that there might be 20,000 other people that eventually are living around that particular one thing that gets built. And they build their thing and they build their thing. And before you know it, you've got this town which is like a labyrinth of all sorts of rooms and locations, many of which you've never seen, never visited. And that's often like how our soul finishes up. So once we get that, then we understand that there's some emotions that are going to have the power to unlock other emotions. And then there's some emotions that are just going to be like the actual pain themselves, where you just feel it and it's done. But there's other emotions that are like going to open a door to quite a number of different pains that you will eventually need to feel. And you also have the choice to put the key in the lock and open the door, or to keep the door closed and keep it locked. And many of us have made that choice. We've made that specific choice to lock up our bad experiences, our negative experiences, and keep them away from us, keep even our own awareness away from that particular experience. Right? And you can see the bigger the fear, probably the more of a labyrinth we've created to protect it. So that makes sense to you, what a governing emotion is? Okay. Well, let's look then at what, like, the three main types of governing emotions. So it's what a governing emotion is. Now, we can talk more about it because with regard to governing emotion, probably one other thing I should mention is that unless you deal with a governing emotion, it's highly unlikely truth will come to you. It's highly unlikely you act in harmony with love. It's highly unlikely, in fact, that you will even feel love without addressing some of these governing emotions. Right? And this is one reason why on the planet today, a lot of people, when they talk about love, they talk about it as if it's not a feeling. So the average, I've seen a lot of things now on the internet and so forth that say, like, God's love is not God's feeling for you. It's something else, something, and a lot of times they don't know what it is, you know. But most people say love is a thought, not a feeling. And that's not the case at all. Love drives thoughts. So the fact that we think that love is a thought is already an indication that we're already quite detuned to experiencing the emotion of love. And the reason why is we have governing emotions that prevent us from feeling the emotion of love. And you can see that terror or fear would be a primary one of those. Yeah. Shame, also another. But all of the fear-based emotions, of which shame, guilt, terror, and those kind of things are, they're all preventing you from feeling love, from understanding truth, from taking loving action, and even being completely humble. Because there's governing emotions that control that. So let's look at the three groups or types of governing emotions. And first one. Now, one thing we need to say here, when I talk about like governing emotions, it's not like a slogan or anything that you need to get the principle that there's the doorway into groups of emotions. Does that make sense? So we're not trying to introduce new slogans or acronyms here. We're trying to get the feel of it, what it feels like to actually process through things. So the first type of governing emotion we've called global, but we're not referring here to the globe. We're not referring here to, you know, a worldwide emotion, although many global emotions are in every person worldwide. We're talking here about a group of emotions where one emotion globally controls almost your entire life and controls almost every decision you make. Right? Now, with every one of these types of governing emotions, there are usually a positive type and a negative type. So to give you an illustration or example of a positive global emotion, if it's positive, faith is one of those. So in other words, if I really had faith, you can see that if you really did have faith, it would drag you through so many events, wouldn't it? You'd be able to overcome so many things if you really had a positive faith, particularly a faith in God. You and a faith in the emotional process, you would already probably be processing emotion, right? Faith is one of these positive global emotions that you can develop. Something that you can develop that's going to help you with every single emotion. It's going to carry you through every single situation. Right? And then you could say another example, a negative global emotion would be fear or terror. You can see that if I'm just basically terrified and every time anything upsets me of any time, I'm basically hitting this global terror that I have, then you can see that this terror is going to govern, control what I then do. And for most of us, the terror controls the entire creation of the facade as well. For all of us, that's the case. So the entire facade is all driven by this terror as well. So we even create whole constructions of our entire life on the top of one single global emotion, one single emotion within us that we refuse to feel. Right? Now, can you see that it makes sense then that if we have a construction on top of one emotion, so if you imagine the emotion of terror is here, just so that's terror, and on top of terror, we have built a whole series of things, let's call it our facade, you can see that if this terror disappears, then it's highly likely the foundation for the facade will also, you're basically removing its foundation, so what's going to happen to the building? It's just going to collapse naturally, isn't it? So you can see straight away that you've got two potential ways of addressing your facade. One way is to pick away at the facade, room by room, situation by situation. But if you don't address this, you're not addressing its foundation. The foundation remains. And so this is the thing with global emotions. They are the foundations of buildings. Now, any unloving building you've created inside of yourself emotionally is going to be driven by an unloving global emotion, a negative global emotion. Any foundation that's positive, like faith, is going to build a different kind of building, a positive, a loving building. You can see straight away that how do I become my loving self? I build with my tools that are loving. How did I become my unloving self? I built with the tools that were unloving. In the first century, I called this foundation built on sand and a foundation built on rock. And many of you may have heard of that illustration from the Bible. Foundations built on sand are foundations that God's laws are trying to are buildings that God's laws are trying to deconstruct. So a building built on a foundation of sand is a building that God's laws are attempting to deconstruct. And all of God's laws are focused on the deconstruction of that particular building. So some of your lives, you're going to find God wants to deconstruct the whole lot of your life. Because that's all you've ever built. And so when you go through the process, you might even get to the point where almost everything in your life is completely different than what you began with. Because most of the things we've constructed using this foundation of terror have been false and things that God wants to deconstruct. And God's laws are going to deconstruct it sooner or later. Right? And many of us have to be prepared for that. And we're not. We're not prepared for that. We want to selectively go, hang on a sec, you're talking to me about deconstructing my entire building? No way, man. I'll have nowhere to live then. And that's the way we feel, isn't it? Once you get rid of my whole facade, where am I going to be? Nowhere. Like, I've got to keep a bit of it, just safe, keep bit of it, just so I can feel like I belong somewhere, even. You'll find, in fact, when God deconstructs some of these buildings, that you'll be left in a very psychologically vulnerable place. And it's only the tools including God's love, that are going to help you build a more solid building, one that will last forever, in fact. Does that make sense? Yeah. Is there any questions about that? So if we have Mary up the back, thanks.
So when you talk about terror, it feels to me that there's a terror of feeling, of experiencing terror itself, of the bodily experience of terror. But are you also talking about terror of specific things? So a terror of my pain, or a terror of just being myself?
Yes, of course. You've got firstly the global terror, which is all about the emotion of terror itself.
So it's the fear of feeling terror bodily, emotionally, of anything.
You're not letting me finish. But.
I'm breaking my own rules.
So the emotion of terror is this a global emotion that we have that governs everything. And it's a refusal to feel the terror itself, the actual refusal. And usually in this place, we've never felt terror for the majority of our lives. In other words, every time terror has come up, we've always jumped to prevent the feeling of it. Right? So that's that one feeling. But there are individual fears associated with our pain, some of which are quite terrifying, but they are individual fears relating to the individual pains that were created, which you'll discover underneath. So you could say underneath the terror, this global emotion of terror, becomes individual false beliefs, fears, that cover over individual amounts of pain. But that's all covered by the terror. The terror is like blanket over that.
So it's terror of terror, really. It's a refusal to experience terror.
Yeah, I don't call it terror of terror. I don't really feel there's any such thing.
No.
It's just the refusal to experience an emotion that we call terror, right? It's a refusal to experience it. Now, for many of you, yes, you think you're terrified of it, but the reality is, like, you haven't even touched it to know what you're terrified of. So, you know, you don't know what you really feel about it. You just automatically detuning from it. You automatically run away from it. So, and this is where I feel a lot of people are, is that this emotion, they don't understand why it's there, right? But I don't feel you can have a fear of feeling terror. All you need to do is choose to feel the emotion of terror itself, and anything that that is constructed by it will automatically start falling down and disappearing. And it's the unwillingness to experience that global emotion of terror. It's not having a terror of the terror, I feel. Does that make sense? Like I know, that's
you.
How people think of it, but to me, it's all just a refusal to use the tools of faith, the positive global emotion of faith, to feel an emotion that is positively, that it is the global emotion in the negative direction. If I have enough faith, I will, and desire, I will feel this emotion of terror.
And is it the case that when I surrender to that terror, I might find it's attached to something, some particular thing, or it's just really about the experience of an emotion that I've previously refused?
You don't care what it's attached to. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
You really don't. It's like you will know what it might be attached to. And as I've pointed out already in previous sessions, the majority of time it's attached to being your real self. Right? Your terror of being your real self in any circumstance. But the reality is that you go through the terror and then you know what it was about. And it's the same with every emotion. You have to go through the emotion before you know what it's about. Most of you with terror and other negative emotions want to know what it's about before you experience it. And that's your problem. That is a big problem, wanting to know in advance what an emotion is and why it's there. The emotion covers over why it's there. So the only way you were going to actually know why it was there was by feeling the emotion, and then you will know why it was there. So many of you are trying to put that back to front. You see, this is the development of our intellect. And we've talked about the intellectual side of things here before. The development of our intellect basically says, I want to know everything before I feel anything. And what I'm saying to you is you've got to get used to knowing nothing before you feel anything. Knowing nothing. But most of you don't feel comfortable with that. Because it feels to you like I've got to surrender to what? I don't know. Right? Tell me what it is first, and then I can feel comfortable with surrendering. And I'm saying no, you're going to have to surrender, and then you'll know what it is that you're surrendering to. But let's move forward, because we need to discuss some more things in this section, and I'm already a bit behind. So can you see there's the global emotion here? You see an example of a global emotion, a positive one, and an example of a negative one, right? Now you can see that the four tools are key, three of them in particular are key global tools. Humility, global emotion. When you have it, you'll find you'll feel a lot of things that you didn't feel before, right? So that's a key tool. The desire, passionate desire to take action, is a global emotion. Right? When you feel it, fear will no longer dictate your actions. You will just not be responding to fear every time you try to act or do something. The fact that you are responding to fear every time you act means you haven't developed the desire strong enough yet. Does that make sense? The positive global emotion. So feeling global emotions is all about allowing the feeling of the negative global emotion, which controls things, and of which there's a few. Terror is one of them, but for some of you there might be different flavors of that, you know, in terms of the way you feel that. But you deconstruct that while at the same time you develop the positive one. Does that make sense to you? So you can develop faith at the same time as addressing the terror. And in fact, that's how it often looks. It's not like one or the other. You're often doing these things together. And in fact, it's highly unlikely you would address terror unless you have some faith in what I'm saying to you about your emotions. The majority of you feel, Jesus told me that I need to deal with my emotions, but I don't believe him. I want to try other methods of progress towards God. And I'm saying, no, God designed this one way to God, and it's through this process. And so many people want to say, no, that can't be right, right? So we'll go off and do some New Age stuff and, you know, do some body work and metaphysical, you know, chakra work, and, you know, we'll go and get this healing done and that healing done and so forth, and that will open me up, right? And it's a reliance on physical things to open up emotionally. The reality is, emotions are driven by other emotions, and they're driven by the will of the soul, not by physical things. You can have no body, no physical body, no spirit body, and still address and feel emotions, right? So that says to me, and if you think of it quite logically, it also means that if I'm intellectually trying to address something, into my intellect being a part of my spirit body, then already I'm spirit body centric rather than soul centric. Already I'm detuning away from the soul, detuning away from my emotional condition. So every time you try to use your intellect to determine what's going on, rather than just sitting with a feeling, that's what you're doing. Yeah? Now, I'm not saying that you can't use your intellect appropriately, because you can. God gave you an intellect to use in harmony with the soul's development. But you can see from the facade, which is a great use of your intellect at the moment, you're being driven by pain and the terror to create an intellect that basically denies that pain and the terror exist. So we're not even logical in this place. What we believe is logical is not logical. And this is why when I present logic to many of you, you get very angry, because you're actually not logical. And anger is an indication that an addiction is being confronted when logic is actually presented. Right, so this is the thing we need to be aware of, is that unless we process through these things emotionally, we're not going to get anywhere. And that's why for many of you, you haven't got very far. Does that make sense? But I want to move on so we can discuss the rest of this section, and then we'll ask some questions about that. The next group of emotions are what we're calling just multiple event-based emotions. So remember the room, the rooms that we talked about at the start. It's like having a room where you had 10, 15, 20 times a certain thing happened to you, and so you decided to, in the first event, you decided to put the first event in the room, you created the room and you put the first event emotions in that room. And then you closed the door and you locked it. And then 2 days later, the same event, the same thing happened to you again. So what you do there is you open the door, shove that experience in the same door and closed it again and locked it. And then 3 days later, another event happened, it was the same thing again. So you open the same door again, put that back into that event, closed it, locked it. Does that make sense? So you just, it's like stuffing all of the experiences from those similar events in one place, internally, psychologically, inside of yourself. So that's what I'd classify as a multiple event emotion, a governing emotion. So that means when I open that door, whatever the blockage to that door is, all of my memories and feelings about these multiple events will start piling out, won't they? Sort of like, imagine this behind this door here, it's piled to the ceiling with junk, and you just open the door and it's like, and all the junk just falls out on top of you. And that's what it's like when you open one of these multiple event doors. All of a sudden, everything just flows on you. Now, the majority of your more powerful belief systems, the more powerful false beliefs and false definitions of love, occurred through multiple events, not just a single thing. It wasn't just one-off time, because if you think about it, if you were loved like 100% of the time except for just one time, so you know 99% out of 100 times you were loved, can you see the 1% probably wouldn't matter to you much? Does that make sense? But if you were loved once and then 99% of the time you were treated unlovingly, then of course those events will matter to you a lot, won't they? So it's exactly the same with your multiple event emotions. What's happening here with these emotions is that you were not loved many, many times. Sin was created many times, whether it was by you not loving you not loving others, or whether it was by others, you know, society or parents. Society or parents in, it created a whole heap of false beliefs and also a whole heap of pain. Now, all the pain was shoved in the door, and then the doorway is all of the false beliefs that keep that door closed. Does that make sense? So all the ways you use to prevent that door, that pain, from ever being opened. And the key is usually one or two, basic global emotions that stop you from turning the key on the door, right, to open the whole thing. So the multiple event emotions, you will have multiple sets of beliefs associated with those events that will all be false. You'll have multiple definitions of love that will all be false associated with that pain, and you will have created those false beliefs and false definitions of love based on not releasing the pain, so the pain isn't released, so the false beliefs got created. And in the process of the false beliefs getting created, now we've got a doorway, for most of us, almost it seems like an impenetrable doorway that we need a key to open. And unless we find this key, the actual emotion that's going to open this door, we'll keep that door closed for good. Now, that key can be a combination of positive and negative global emotions, can't it? It could be like one thing we might need to open all of our doors is faith. So it's sort of like a master key, faith. We can open all the doors. Or another key is accepting emotion itself, just allowing myself to surrender to emotion no matter what. That's going to be like a master key, isn't it? It's going to help us open any door. But then there's other things where we just don't want to remember a certain thing. We just don't want to remember that this is what it was like, for whatever justified reasons. Sometimes those reasons are to do with the fact that we're still having a relationship with the very person who hurt us. And so we close the door, lock it, while we're in that relationship, and then all of a sudden we leave that relationship and now there's no imperative to leave the door closed anymore. So we open it. Sometimes it's like that. The key is, and I'm not saying about the actual keys now, I'm saying the actual key about the method is allow that to occur all the time. Don't wait until a relationship is terminated before you deal with that relationship. Deal with it as you go. And this is what you learn after a while. But the governing emotions usually close you down from doing that, stop you from doing that. Does that make sense, Laura?
You know how you've often drawn that diagram of the desire and fear scale and mm-hmm. the fear? That would apply here with all our techniques, denial techniques, the desire to feel some of these global emotions would have to be higher than the, yeah. So yeah. For me,
so
for
if
example,
the fear is this high, is what you're saying,
yeah.
And the desire is this high,
yeah.
There's two ways, nothing's going to happen, is it? We're not going to feel that, right? Because our desire isn't great enough to overcome our fear. Now, there's two ways to fix that. One way is to release our fear as an emotion, which will pull our fear down, while at the same time developing a desire as an emotion, which will push our desire up. Mm. Once our desire exceeds our fear, we'll process the emotion.
Because that even just working with the denial techniques that we spoke about today, the blaming and justifying, even that this needs to take place just to accept the facade. Yeah.
Yeah. And what I'm suggesting is that there are some events, some governing emotions that control even your desire. Just one emotion that controls all of your desires. Mm. And unless you address that one emotion, then you'll never develop desire. And so it would make sense, wouldn't it, that we focus on that emotion first. Mm-hmm. But you know what most of us do? We focus on it last or not at all. Because they are the emotions that scare us the most. And because of the global terror, anything that scares us, we
avoid.
Yeah.
Thanks.
Yep. So this is a problem, you see. We're constantly being selective and we've got to learn to not be selective emotionally. But we're constantly being selective, and even some of our selective emotions, some of the global emotions, control even the extent of our desire. And so as a result, there's global emotions, negative ones, that are suppressing our desire. The global emotion of faith builds desire. The global emotions of fear suppress desire. And unless I have desire greater than my fear, you can see the problem. So you can see why we're going to have to do a lot of fear work. Because it's the fear that finishes up governing, a global emotion of terror, that finishes up governing the entire system. And that's why we're going to have to go through it. You follow? Yeah. Can we move on? Because there's a third group. There's a single event emotions. So governing emotion is a single event. So example. In my childhood, my dad may have left me. It's a single event. Dad left home. Never returned. Single event. Now, it could control quite a lot of emotions, but it's not going to be anywhere near the emotions of my mother's response to dad leaving. Do you understand? Because that's multiple events. So my mother's response to dad leaving is actually going to damage me more than my father leaving. Interesting, hey? But our father might have died or whatever, same kind of thing. There's a single event, but the multiple events are my mother's feelings about that, because that she imposed those thereafter. Does that make sense to you? So what we're often thinking of is, oh, this is all go back to my dad leaving or goes back to my mum doing this one thing. No, it often does not. It often completely the opposite of what you think. And the reason why you don't know that is because you haven't felt about it yet. When you feel about it, you know that. You can see, that was one event. So and once I process that, I feel quite a lot different, that one event. But there's a whole lot of other associated events. There were multiple events that we ignore because in this case, we've still got probably our relationship with our mother. So in case of dad leaving, mum staying, mum looked after me the rest of my life. She's probably still in my life. My dad's not in my life. I can process the single event emotion relating to my dad quite easily. But when it comes to processing the multiple event emotions relating to my mum, I'm even refusing to do it because she's still there, still imposing those same beliefs about that same situation on me. Does that make sense? So this is why we need to understand. And the reason why it's good to understand this beforehand, this is something that I've had to discover through the feeling of my own emotions, which, and what I'm suggesting to you is, at this stage for you, it'll be an intellectual concept only, but as you work your way through different things, you'll start seeing this picture build of, wow, this is one of those emotions that I just changed one emotion, bang, like a lot of things in my life are different now. And that was related only to, you know, it was related to, I don't even know what it was related to. So a lot of our global emotions and we develop within us before we even have cognizance intellectually. We deal with it and all of a sudden, bang, our life changes and we didn't have any idea what that emotion was about. And the reality is you don't have to. You don't have to know. Isn't that wonderful? You can just deal with it, get on, and don't have to know even what it was about. Now, so that's one half of this discussion about global emotions. The governing emotions, the global, multiple event, and single event emotions. And obviously, you can see that a global emotion has a far more power over your life, far more power to infiltrate everything you do, far more power to infiltrate your big building, right, which is you, far more power to infiltrate all of that. And the reason why it has more power is because it affects everything in that building, right? Whereas a multiple event emotion is more like a few rooms within a room. A single event emotion, probably just a room. If it was intense enough, it'd probably just a room. If it's not intense enough, it'd be just a little smidge of emotion here and there. These are usually the ones you prefer to address. These are the ones usually we completely ignore, and these are the ones we're completely terrified of. And this is why also we're terrified of developing faith. Because faith is a positive global emotion that's going to help us through everything. So we're terrified of developing faith. We have a fear of developing faith. We don't want to develop faith. It's going to pull us through a lot of things that otherwise, that at this stage we don't want to address. You see? Okay. So just a couple of questions about that and then we can move forward. Lorleen, thanks. Remember, you've still got the Q&A on this so we can ask more questions.
Feeling that I'm a victim is a multiple event or not even?
Well, it's probably been being created by multiple events, yes. Yep, probably. Yep. Suzanne?
And just going back to the Series 1 sessions, all of this can be undone by faith, truth, action and emotion.
Yeah.
So you don't really need to get into, like, it's good to understand this.
Yes.
But if you just start out on the other, it'll eventually take you through
correct.
All this.
Correct.
Yeah.
Yep. And Alex?
Is this also why working through blocks with God is the most important thing
yes.
to do first?
Because that's where your faith is.
Yeah.
That's right.
And that'll pull you through, hey?
Correct.
Yeah.
Yeah, so your faith issues are attitudes with God. Very important to address as soon as you can address them. Because if you don't address them soon, they'll go on and on and on, and you'll sit in this state of limbo, stagnation for many years without having that driving you and pulling you. See, the positive global emotions pull you in positive direction. They help you address a lot of emotion. Yeah. So very important. You can see faith is popping up a lot, right? through this course now, you're going to need faith in order to address these emotions. Definitely faith, most important quality to develop. It is why Solomon in the presentation he did remember in the Paget messages, he was asked what are the most important things in the universe, and he said God's love on the part of God and man's faith on the part of man. Because it's the faith that is a global emotion, pulls you through anything. It'll pull you through your terror. Faith will pull you through your terror. Okay. Well, let's look at another problem we have, and that is the way that we perceive things when it comes to emotion. So we want to just leave that there for a moment. And this section now we're addressing are the main reasons. In your outline, I think you've got it, the main causes of sin. Is that right? The major cause of sin. But actually, I would like to call it the main reasons for sin, because there are many causes for sin, but these are some main reasons for why we engage sin. The first main reason is the problem with faith, which Alex just identified, right? Which is the refusal to develop faith. So this, the refusal being a negative global emotion, faith being the positive global emotion, and our refusal to develop it a negative global emotion, it's going to affect everything. So while we refuse to have faith in God, God's goodness, God's love, God's kindness, God, the way God created my soul, the abilities that God gave my soul to cope with anything in the world emotionally, all of these things I need to have faith in. And my refusal to develop faith is going to have a large impact on my inability to progress. So the more I refuse faith, the more unable I will be to progress. I will not be able to progress. And of course you can say the opposite is true. Obviously if I develop a desire to develop faith, I develop an aspiration to develop faith, this is going to be a positive global influence on me. It'll affect everything that I do positively, which would be fantastic, right? So very powerful to know that. Yeah. Just check my time. 12:30. Okay. The second problem that we have is this problem. The refusal to release terror. And remember that when I talk about a release, I'm talking about the emotional experience of terror, the refusal to experience it. So these two global emotions, one a positive one that we're refusing to develop, and one, a negative one that we're refusing to release, are having the most powerful effect on us. They powerfully affect all of our lives. Right? And this brings us to our perception of how we see our life currently. And this is what I'd like to now speak with you. So we've now got this refusal to develop faith and refusal to release terror as our primary issues. And what we want to do is look at our perception of this issue now in terms of how we see everything. And in your outline, you see some diagrams where we've got like the soul like a container. Right? And this is where we've got two containers, you could say. One container is our perception, and the other container is God's truth about the reality. Maybe I'll just draw them a bit bigger so I can write some words on there. So this one is God's view, and this one is our view, my view, we'll call it, shall we? My view is that my current level of pain is quite minor. This is why I stay in it, because I believe it's minor. See, if I had a different perception of it, I would want to deal with it. But because I believe it's quite minor in comparison to everything else, I don't deal with it. And instead what I see is my terror is the major thing. And then the childhood pain, so this is how I see pain. My childhood pain I see is quite major as well, bigger than my current pain. That's how I perceive things. All of you are perceiving it this way at the moment. Right? So this is your current view of how you see it. Right? But the reality is quite different. The truth is that my current pain is the largest amount of pain. And the only way it's going to get worse is that if I add to it by sinning more. And then it will get bigger again and bigger again and bigger again. And it will keep getting bigger and bigger. And for some people in the hells of the spirit world, it's so intense that they're screaming in agony with it all the time. Literally. That's how much pain they have. And yet they still engage the next sin. So there are many people in the spirit world who influence people here on earth. And if you could watch what happens, they are screaming in agony, waiting for their next addiction to get met. And the next addiction might be to harm a person or cause a rape or cause a murder or something like that. That might be their next addiction. So they cause it by what they project that the individual's involved, so that it actually happens. And now, because of that, there's an instant result inside of their soul of extra pain. And they scream in agony about the fact that it just happened. But their addiction is still more intense. And they keep going until such a time as the pain is so intense they're exhausted by it. And then they stop. That's the only time they stop. Now, you don't want to do that. Trust me, if you could see what was going on, you definitely would not want to do it. Now, if you think about it, see the contrast. Here, we're saying my current pain is tiny or little. And for most of us, we think it's tiny, like just a little smidge across the top, just like a little tiny layer, you know, I can handle it layer. You know, when you're telling yourself, basically, you can handle how you are now. But the reality is, from God's perspective, is that your current pain is the most amount of pain you're ever going to experience, except for one thing, and that is if you sin again. And then there'll be more. So the current pain you're actually in is the worst pain you have. But most of you don't believe that. Most of you have so detuned from pain, you can't even feel that. Right, but it is true from God's perspective. And then we've got a smidge of terror to feel from God's perspective. And then we've got, yes, some bad childhood experiences that we need to experience and release. But it's not as big as what we imagine. Now, the average person who passes in the spirit world has had, like, say, a 70 to 90-year life, right? And yet they can become at one with God. On the average, a person in that situation can become at one with God but in 30 years. Right? Now, that tells you that of the 90-year life, there has to be only at least 30 years that was related to their current pain. And the rest had to be smaller than that. Because it's the current pain that caused by their sin that creates most of their pain. So the rest had to be smaller than that. And the rest had to be learning lessons, you know, truth lessons, joyful learning experiences. But see, we don't see it that way. We don't see it that way. We see a mountain where there's a molehill, and then where there's a molehill, we see a mountain. And this is because of our perception of pain. Our perception of pain is distorted, skewed. We've desensitized to our current pain, while at the same time completely blocked off and terrified of experiencing the actual pain, the childhood pain. And as a result of blocking off and being terrified of the childhood pain, we're now engaging a whole heap of actions, a whole heap of sin, which are causing more and more and more and more intense pain that we're trying harder and harder and harder to detune from. Now, is it no wonder by the time we're 90 that there's so many lines in our faith you can't see our face anymore? It's no wonder, isn't it? With all that fear and all that terror and all that pain that's all been stored up in our soul that's now being reflected on the body, it's no wonder the bodies can't work. There's not enough flow of energy anymore coming to the bodies from our soul. Our soul's just terrified to do anything, to experience anything in that place. And that's the state that most of us pass in. Right. We can reverse that, but not without changing our view. While you maintain that this is true, and you don't develop faith that this is true, you will not do anything about your emotions. Right. So, Lani, thanks.
So, is that because we're so used to the current pain, we think it's a normal condition?
Yes. Not only do we think it's normal, we use a whole lot of suppressive techniques to avoid it. So, you know, you listed some of those today in the feedback with Mary, you know, the review with Mary. You know, you run around busy, so you don't even have time to feel your body, feel what's really going on soul-wise. You stuff yourself with food so much. The majority of the planet, the more food they have available to themselves, the fatter they get. Why is that? Because we just go eat. And if we live in a more affluent society, of course the bigger we're going to get because we're just eating to suppress. And then we do a whole heap of suppressive things with medications. Medication after medication after medication, all done to suppress the physical pain. And the physical pain is there because we've already suppressed the emotional pain. So we are like adepts. We're masters at avoiding pain. So it's no wonder that we see it like this, right? But that is a part of our problem. We're not seeing that what we're creating in our sin is more pain, more pain, more pain. That part is actually quite large and getting bigger by the moment. Every time we engage another sin, it's bigger again. Every time we engage another activity out of harmony with God's laws of love, bigger again. And yet the terror and the childhood pain is fixed. It's not getting bigger. It's limited. It's finished now. We're adults now. Those things are not happening to us anymore, so they are actually fixed in their size. Can you see? So the terror and the childhood pain is a fixed size, finite size, whereas the current pain is actually an ever-growing, ever-increasing pain because we're choosing to avoid the two finite pains, the ones that are already fixed and already determined, already there, and can't be increased. You see? So we don't realize that what we're doing is we're creating a whole heap of pain that's slowly increasing based upon our choices and decisions, and not seeing that actually the fixed childhood pain, which is the whole point of the terror to avoid, and the terror itself are actually limited. And it's like we're so afraid of touching these two things in the diagram, the pain itself and the terror as an emotional experience. We're so afraid of touching them that we're willing to create a mountain of pain in order to avoid the molehill of pain. Crazy, hey? It's just crazy when you think about it. But we don't even think about it. If you thought about it, you might not do it anymore, but we don't even think about it. And we don't think about it because none of us have ever been taught to even think about it. We've all just been taught from their childhood to just avoid pain at all costs and be terrified of it. Right? So we've got to have some compassion for the fact that we're building this mountain out of a molehill because we've taught that the molehill is unbearable. And you know what's going to finish up feeling fairly unbearable? It's the mountain. That eventually will stop creating once the pain gets too intense. But when will that be? That, you know, are we going to continue all this life until we pass? And then continue for another few hundred years after then, creating more pain after we've passed? Because you can do that. A lot of people have this imagination, you know, that once you pass, you know, this whole New Age concept, once you pass, you're now enlightened. You're not going to continue pain anymore. You're going to sit down and assess it all. What a heap of crap. I've hardly seen anybody ever do that. Like, and I've seen, you know, millions of people pass. Most people I see who pass engage exactly the same behaviour they did before they passed, which means they continue creating more pain for a period of time until they realise what's going on, and then they stop. All right? So Amber, up the back, thanks.
So if we dive headfirst into this process, it looks apparent to me up on the board that the first section of it's probably going to be the most overwhelming and most intense, and that's going to be the point where we either makes us or breaks us.
Probably, because this is the mountain we've created. This is the molehill that we can't change until we release. This is the mountain we created. Like, so obviously deconstructing that, and you're not going to feel much of God's love while you're deconstructing that, although God's going to very much love you doing it. So you'll definitely feel at times, I can just feel my guys going, you beauty, another one down, another one gone, another one bites the dust. Right? That's what will happen. But, you know, we've got to see... We've got to get the perspective right inside of us emotionally. So emotionally, our perspective is skewed before we begin. And that's part of our problem. And most of you, for no matter how much I talk about this, you yet don't feel it as a belief inside of you. You feel this perspective, this current view, my view. You feel this perspective. And that's why everything's so terrifyingly frightening for you when you start addressing anything, because you're still seeing it in this perspective. And that's notwithstanding the fact that if I had some faith in God, I would realize God's good, and obviously God's given me tools to release this stuff. God will help me through the process of release. So even discounting all that in this terrified place. And on top of that, we're holding on to this false view. We're imagining that it's going to be much, 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 much more worse than we can imagine. And you know what's worse than you can currently imagine? Your current state. Isn't that interesting? Yeah. So if we come down to Sandra. Sorry, I'm going over on this. I'll cut down the Q&A as we go. Perhaps what we should do now is just finish the presentation, shall we? And go and just have our 10-minute break and just go straight onto the Q&A. That way we've got plenty of time to ask that. So what if we do that? And I'll come to you, Sandra, if you can remember the question you had. So what we'll do is we'll finish now, and if you come back at quarter to one, we'll get started on the Q&A.